Hello, this is Lazarus at Telecom Tech, where telecom and networking technologies are simply explained. Today, we'll be simply explaining VXLAN encapsulation, headers, and packet transmission. If you like my content so far, and you're interested in seeing more networking and telecom technologies simply explained, then please subscribe now to the channel. If you like this video, please make sure to click that thumbs up button. VXLAN is a technology that can be used to overcome the limitations of the more traditional Ethernet VLANs defined by the IEEE 802.1Q standard. Take a look at my previous two videos for an introduction to VXLAN and to the various components it uses. Today we'll be looking into the VXLAN header and the encapsulation process that takes place when layer 2 segments are spanned across a VXLAN infrastructure. Let's take a look at the VXLAN header once again. This header is appended to the conventional Ethernet header before it is encapsulated into a UDP datagram, and it contains the VNI to which that frame belongs. This whole section here, which is indicated by this green box, is the encapsulated frame along with the VXLAN header. Now, in order for this frame to be sent from this VTEP to its destination VTEP across the overlay network, it must be encapsulated into a UDP datagram like so. The datagram is then encapsulated into an IP header with the IP address belonging to the underlay network. Encapsulation continues with whatever layer 2 technology is used on that underlay network. Now, the underlay network and everything that's happening within these headers here is completely abstracted from the operation of VXLAN and from the overlay network. The underlay network is oblivious to the contents of that UDP datagram. The only thing the underlay network does is it routes traffic from one VTEP to another. Since it has a destination IP address, it can get that packet to the destination VTEP. Now, once there, the decapsulation process takes place, the VXLAN header is read, and the frame is then placed on the appropriate layer 2 segment. Now, let's go through in detail how communication takes place between two hosts that are communicating on the same layer 2 segment across a VXLAN infrastructure. Here we have two hosts, PC1 and PC2, with the stated MAC addresses and IP addresses that are used by each one. They're on the same layer 2 segment, and this segment within the VXLAN infrastructure corresponds to VNI 6501. Now we have two VTEPs which have been configured with VXLAN to allow this layer 2 segment to span the entire underlay network. Now remember, that underlay network can be anything at all. It can be the internet, it can be a WAN network, it can be an MPLS network, anything at all, just as long as the VTEPs have layer 3 connectivity to each other. Now here we see PC1 sending data to PC2. And here we see the contents of the packets that are being sent. As you can see, we have the normal IP headers with the appropriate source and destination IPs. Those are the IP addresses of PC1 and PC2. And we also have the source and destination MACs, also the source and destination MACs of PC1 and PC2. Now, PC1, as it's sending this data, is completely unaware of the VXLAN infrastructure. Now, once that frame reaches our VTEP, VXLAN kicks in. And this is where all of the magic happens. Here, the VTEP takes this frame and appends the VXLAN header. Now, the VTEP knows what VNI to use because the VTEP has been configured with a corresponding mapping of the port on which PC1 is connected to and the VNI that corresponds to it. Now, at this point, the VTEP will do a lookup to find the mapping between the destination MAC address and the remote VTEP IP address. And that's how the local VTEP determines the destination VTEP from this mapping. Now, once the mapping is determined, then that VXLAN is placed within a UDP datagram with a destination port of 4789, which is the reserved UDP port used by VXLAN. This is then encapsulated into an IP packet. Now this IP packet belongs to the underlay network. Here we see source and destination IP addresses of the VTEP interfaces of the source and destination VTEPs. And in the destination IP address field, we have the IP address of our destination VTEP that we have determined during that mapping process that we talked about before. Then this IP packet is further encapsulated into Ethernet or whatever other layer 2 technology that may be used on this underlay network. Now, using these UDP and IP and Ethernet headers, this packet is routed to the destination VTEP. The contents of the packet are unknown to the underlay network, and it essentially doesn't care because it just tunnels that packet to the appropriate destination VTEP. Once that packet reaches the destination VTEP, the outer IP and UDP headers are stripped during the encapsulation, and that VXLAN header is also read in order to determine to which VNI that frame belongs. Once that's determined, the frame is then placed in the appropriate layer 2 segment. And all we're left with now is our conventional Ethernet frame, which contains the original IP packet and the upper layer headers and the data itself. So that's it. It sounds rather simple, doesn't it? Because usually when we think about VXLAN, we think about more complex configurations. Well, there is one thing that I didn't go into detail about, and that's how the source VTEP looks up the destination VTEP's IP address based on the destination MAC address. This mapping is arguably one of the more involved aspects of VXLAN, and there are actually several technologies that allow us to achieve it. First of all, you can statically configure unicast VXLAN tunnels so that the mapping of destination MACs to destination VTEP IPs is manually configured. Using a multicast underlay network is another solution, and this is actually the solution that the VXLAN standard suggests. If you read up on that RFC that I've linked below, you'll find that this is the solution that's described there. But there are two more solutions available. You can use multi-protocol BGP with Ethernet VPN, which is a popular solution for data centers and private clouds, or you can use LISP, Locator Identifier Separation Protocol, which is popular in software-defined network deployments, or SDN deployments. We'll talk more about these technologies and how they are used for mapping MACs to VTEPs in upcoming videos. We'll focus more on the first two, but all of them are valid and deployable solutions. So that's it for today. I hope you found this video useful, and if you have, please click that thumbs up button. If you'd like me to address other related topics, feel free to let me know in the comments below. And please subscribe to get updates to newly published videos. I'm Lazarus at Telecom Tech. I hope this has been helpful for you, and I'd like to thank you for watching.